please.
Welcome to Estoril. It's a bit different from Russia.
A little bit.
Although we have a big Russian community that's very important for Portugal also.
Absolutely.
Let's start by the beginning. Why did you go to Russia today?
Well, I started in 2011, and they had found one of my reports online, and they reached out to me, and they said, we have an opportunity here in Washington, D.C., where you can cover important stories that the mainstream media ignores, where you can really challenge the narrative, the Western-dominated narrative is what they say. And so they pitched it to me as an opportunity to do these kinds of stories. And you got to think at the time, it was a very different time. Ukraine was not in the news.
Right.
Russia was not really in the news. Certainly Russian media was not in the news. But the world has changed a lot. I mean, by the day, by the week, by the months, over the year.
But so I'm not telling a wrong story if I will tell that you wanted to change the world by working for Russia Today.
Well, that's kind of a lofty ambition, but as a journalist, I'm sure you, in your little way, you know, you want to try to do good, and
no, but
eventually
seriously, you wanted to tell stories from a different angle that was not the angle from the mainstream media that we know, BBC, CNN, etc., right?
And I think that's the thing, and I think that's the appeal, and that's how they appeal to a niche kind of audience in the U.S. and throughout the world that tend to be skeptical and critical of the West, of America, of the leadership, of the political and powerful institutions that tend to be skeptical.
Although if I have friends in Russia Today, as you know, that started in 2005, although it was thought at 2003. And their idea was not so much anti-Western, was we want to promote the Russian culture, the Russian worldview.
Right.
Did you feel that there was that presence of a Russian cultural, or this was like only a word?
There was. I think that when the channel was launched, there was that idea to just improve the image of Russia globally. Because, I mean, it doesn't really have the best image in terms of human rights, freedom of expression. And I think that there was that goal there to improve the image of Russia. Unfortunately, I think that it changed, and the role of it changed. And I think that there is that opportunity that is there, and it does serve that function of providing another point of view. I think where it gets particularly problematic, and as we've seen in Ukraine, is when it comes to foreign policy issues, when it comes to issues that involve Russia politically, when it comes to Russian allies, that's when it's used, that's when it crosses over into propaganda.
Moving a bit into private, in a sort of a private matter, you explained so vividly that your father came from Hungary.
Your grandfather
came from Hungary in 56 during the revolution. Mm-hmm. How did your father, the son of your grandfather, how did he react to the when you broke the news that you were going to work in Russia Today?
I mean, honestly, at the time, again, it was a different time. I think now we're all looking at it in retrospect. But they pitched it as just another, like Al Jazeera English, another international news channel.
Yeah, so they saw it as a professional opportunity.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
And Thomas, what did you find in Russia Today? So you were based in Washington, D.C.
Mm-hmm.
How was the working ambience? I mean, were you getting along with your Russian colleagues and Americans?
I tried my best to get along with them. However, you know, when they tried to push an angle that I didn't feel comfortable with, I would kind of push back. And it's kind of a gradual pressure that they put on you. And so people ask, you know, how does it work? How does this propaganda machine work? And it's kind of hard to explain because it's convoluted by design. It's not like we have a morning meeting and we have a direct line to the Kremlin and they're gonna say, you're gonna say this, 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 and this on behalf of the Kremlin. It doesn't quite work like that.
So President Putin never phoned you saying, hey Liz, don't
I don't know if he's phoned my bosses, it's possible, I don't know. But it's more of a self-censorship and it's more of, you kind of have to guess right. There's not the journalistic rules, checks and balances
that are typically in place. Did you ever feel some sort of pressure saying, hey Liz, don't talk about this or talk about that?
Yeah, The thing is that you need to, you kind of need to know the right questions to ask, the right angles to push, and the right kind of stories to tell that fit in line with a certain narrative. And if you don't, if you don't perform that function, well, then you're not looked upon favorably. You know, there's been, I think as I grew more disillusioned, there were things that had happened, interviews that were censored. I'm gonna give you one example.
The Ron Paul thing?
Oh, that was the day of, yeah.
Yeah.
But I would say there was one time, if you can recall, during when NATO had intervened in Mali.
Yeah.
And I did an interview with a gentleman that described what it was like to live under terrorist threats, under Sharia law, and very well spoken. It was a great interview. My colleagues saw it, they had agreed. But I was told that it was a weak interview and it didn't see that they never aired it. Hmm. Why? Because it made NATO look like a positive force. And that's not the aim there. It's to make NATO, to make the EU, to make the US look like we're just hypocritical and just a negative force. So there's kind of that I would say that the ultimate aim there is to make the West look bad and to paint Russia favorably
in
comparison.
Let's go back to this video. Okay, so you arrive to the studio, you prepare your newscasts. This was after you were reading the news before this?
It was, yeah.
This
was before the annexation of Crimea and around the ouster of Yanukovych.
Yeah.
So that's when the protests were really.
So you started to read the news about things?
Yeah. I mean, they were. We were covering Ukraine very heavily.
Right.
And whereas I was used to a situation in the U.S. anchoring.
Yeah, but I'm talking about this precise day. So
and
the
on
precise
this,
day
this
when you
precise
resigned.
Day, we went very heavy on Ukraine, and every story was propagandized.
Right.
I will say, you know, I would toss to my colleague on the ground, here are all the neo-Nazis in Ukraine causing a ruckus. Oh, here comes the Russians as the peacekeeping, what's the word that they used? Self-defense forces.
Right.
And that's the way it works. And I think that journalists and political leaders, and I think that we're finally getting to a point where we're understanding, whereas Russian media was kind of seen as a menace, we're seeing now how it can have real effects on the ground can be actually dangerous and destructive.
But you had the conscience that you were going to do a step in your life that would cost you something, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what was gonna happen.
Did you inform anyone before?
I informed because as I grew more disillusioned and Ukraine was it for me. I just felt disgusted. I felt like I was part of a problem. I don't know, even if it was a small part, I felt disgusted that I was part of this organization that was having real effects on the ground in Ukraine and affecting people's livelihood. I no longer wanted to be a part of it. So I decided that was it. That was my red line. And I was gonna go quietly. There was a reporter at the Daily Beast that I had been in contact with, and I had told him that I was gonna come forward and talk more about the way that it works and the way we are manipulating the situation in Ukraine.
But
I told him I was gonna do it.
So you talked to the Daily Beast before?
The day of, I went into the bathroom and I said, I'm gonna do it on the air because this is just out of hand.
And the people in the studio, they were not prepared for what you were going to say?
They were not.
Well, what was the reaction? Why didn't they just take you just off air and just
I think that
go
it was
into solemn music or a ballet?
Yeah, people ask that. That's why there's so many conspiracy theories out there. It's amazing.
Why did they let you go public with this message?
Why did they let me? Well, they didn't let me. I went off script, and I think that you know, the control room.
So you mean
in my ear, they were like, Liz, Liz,
where,
prompter,
where would they
Liz,
say?
Teleprompter.
Yeah.
And
did they say stop, Liz?
They did. They did. But at that point, I think that it would have. I think it would have looked worse to just fade to black.
Right. It would look like an emergency situation.
It would have,
So after, okay, you just took your, we saw that you threw your papers, you took the mic probably. Who was the first person that talked to you after? Your editor or?
Yeah, the news director, the Russian news director. He has to have a word with me in his office.
What did he say to you, that you were shocked?
He asked me why I did it.
Yeah.
And I had explained that I had voiced my concerns that we're becoming increasingly propagandized. We're essentially lying about what's happening there. We're leaving out essential facts, that we're not doing a service. And I had mentioned some personal reasons on the air And so that was it. And then maybe about 10, 15 minutes went by, and just the story blew up. It went viral very quickly.
Were you surprised by the conspiracy theories about you leaving? Some people saying, I didn't see the kind of conspiracy theories that we see in other. I didn't. No one said you were an extraterrestrial or something.
But
they say, well, she's a CIA. She's a CIA agent that was implanted, or she has this or that. There was a guy that accused you of being a Russian agent that was doing a double game. Okay, so were lots of conspiracy. were you surprised by this?
I guess no, because one thing that had troubled me about this station in particular was the way that they feed off of conspiracy theories.
Right.
So it was interesting that eventually the response that they had come up with about me was that I was part of this greater conspiracy theory. And this is the kind of message that audience is receptive to. And so what I really learned about it was just with my experience in being accused of being in the middle of a conspiracy theory is the way that conspiracy theories actually function in Russian media. In MH17, for example, right away, as journalists all over the world were struggling to figure out the facts.
For our public, just to remind that MH17 is the Malaysian plane that was down in Donetsk.
And right away, Russian media, before, as journalists were trying to scramble and figure out the facts, before you knew it, within a matter of hours, I would say, they were already putting out a bunch of theories out there that it was actually the Ukrainians that shot down the jet targeting President Putin. Sure. And so, I mean, how does that work? Why are Russians interested in conspiracy theories?
Well, not only Russians, I mean, like Americans are also interested.
Russian media in particular are interested in conspiracy theories.
You recall the famous movie with Mel Gibson, Conspiracy Theory, where he's a taxi driver and he believes in all conspiracies.
I have not seen that movie.
There's lots of people in the States that also believe in conspiracy theories. I mean,
and this is who they, it definitely targets that audience.
See the conspiracy theory about Barack Obama, that is not an American citizen, that is, that is a covert Muslim that doesn't confess that he's a Muslim. I mean, so I'm sorry, United States also is full of.
Let's put
this in perspective. What, as a journalist, what is the line that you can draw between propaganda and information that is, let's say, very patriotic?
I think you might be asking what the difference is between opinion and fact.
That also, that will go there. But when do you see that something is propaganda?
I would say something's propaganda when, and I would actually say that what we're experiencing in this blitz and increasing expansion of Russian media internationally and the investment that they're putting into this, I think that the word propaganda doesn't even adequately explain the phenomenon that is happening right now. But I think when disinformation, which is essentially actively manipulating the truth, manipulating facts or taking bits and pieces of information and manipulating it to the point where it's no longer the truth, where the aim is no longer to, I mean, as journalists, you would hope that the ultimate goal is to inform the public, to get the truth out. And I can tell you firsthand that that's not the goal in Russian media. It's to manipulate the truth to further foreign policy
and
interests.
There is also some selective use of truth. I mean, so the story that you mentioned about the Nazis in Ukraine, of course, we know that there are lots of Nazi groups in Ukraine, but was there any news on the Nazi groups in Russia? I mean, like the Russian National Unity and other groups that are also reproducing motives that we can say national socialism. I mean, were you allowed to treat these things also?
No,
what is happening in Russia?
You didn't touch them and you just knew not to.
Yeah. So tell me one thing. Russia bought a powerful media, Russia Today, that I think they are still owned by RIA Novosti or a company that is connected to RIA Novosti.
But I think the funding.
Yeah, but the funding is state funding,
yes.
Basically. They have this powerful television. Do you think it's possible, just possible, that this will be transformed again into media that could attract other Liz Walls, full of pure intentions? Is it possible for this to be reformed?
I think that with all the news that's out there, I think that people should know better by now. And hopefully we've learned from this conflict in Ukraine. And that we learn from it. And it's still, unfortunately, I mean, there was the Minsk agreement in February. It's constantly being violated, and there's a big fear about from diplomats on the ground, military officials on the ground, that Russia is actually preparing for another offensive. So I think that as journalists, we need to look at the way, I mean, we heard from the commander of NATO, Captain Breedlove. Yeah, he was just shocked. He's like, something, the quote was somewhere along the lines of, this is the biggest propaganda blitz that we've seen in history, something like that. And it was information. This information war is instrumental to Russia's foreign policy right now.
Just some weeks ago, we went to Capitol Hill to talk
as a
qualified witness with a Russian journalist, Peter
Pomerantsev.
To talk to U.S. Congress on propaganda, disinformation, what is happening. A friend of mine told me Liz Wall managed to put Democrats and Republicans speaking in the same tone. Did you believe that?
Wow.
Do you think that the congressmen really all supported your points of view, or they thought, oh no, maybe she's exaggerating. There is no propaganda. This is, she's just pulling a trick.
No, honestly, that's not the impression that I got at all. And the chair of the House Committee on Foreign Affairs, he is very serious about the U.S. answering or having a response to Russian propaganda. And I think with what has happened in Ukraine, we see military leaders, world leaders in the U.S., obviously with this hearing, signaled that this is a serious issue and we need to respond somehow, because the propaganda campaign is on the Russian side. It's working.
Yeah.
So what do we do? How do we respond to this?
But you believe in what? Censorship? You think
no.
You should censor televisions like Russia Today?
I don't. Well, first of all, I think that that's a question that we get a lot. How do we it's a difficult one.
How do you fight propaganda?
How do we respond to this? Do you fight it with more propaganda? No, because I think that would create just more chaos. I think that we should report the truth, but we need to amplify the truth. And I think that what Russian media is really successful with right now is they're able to harness the power of the internet, of newer technology. They understand the way to utilize new technology and the internet, and how to really rapidly put theories out there.
Sure, but when you talk about Russian media, now let me play devil's advocate. Tomorrow we are going to have here one of the great voices of dissent in Russia, Garry Kasparov.
Yes.
You had Boris Nemtsov that was just gunned in front of the Kremlin. You have all the people in Yabloko. You have people from several kinds and walks of life. You have things like Echo Moskvy. Echoes of Moscow, which has been an independent newspaper. So can we put everything in the same bag, saying this is Russian propaganda? There are people trying to fight that, right, inside of Russia.
They are, and they're having an increasingly difficult time doing so. The opposition, they're getting pushed out economically. I mean, in so many ways. And the media there, independent media, we're seeing that they're being squeezed out. And we're seeing that more resources are being funneled into expanding Russian propaganda or disinformation, whatever. We need a new word. Got to figure out what that new word is. So I think
there is a word, the Russian desinformatia.
That works. So I think that, as much as we can, we need to, journalists around the world that are keeping a close eye on Ukraine and reporting on these issues, need to be aware of the tactics that Russian media uses, and to try to counter it by amplifying the truth. And I think by getting the facts out there, and when, let's say, if the Kremlin puts out a lie or a skewed fact or a misinformation, disinformation, that we respond quickly and that we correct it and we call it out and we don't fall victim to it, that we don't give, and this is another thing that they take advantage of, the way Western media operates. For example, you know, I've worked in other newsrooms and we tend to really value objectivity. I know that's changing, and but you know, if we're reporting a straight news story, we try to give two sides to the story.
Right.
And so here's what this person says, here's what this person says. But if you have a journalist that is really interested in investigating the truth,
right.
and then you have an organization that is just putting out nonsense, well, if you're presenting two sides of the story, instead of coming to a bigger truth, you come to just more chaos. Right. You just don't know what's true. You don't know what's correct. You don't know what's right. And to the public, to the viewer, that might not be paying close attention to everything that's happening.
But if I would put
everybody kind of gives up. Right. We don't know what's true anymore.
But if I would put myself into the shoes of lots of Russians, what they will tell you is that they are not doing propaganda. Who is doing propaganda is a thing like CNN or Fox yeah. News or CBS or ABC or NBC.
That's what they believe.
So I mean, it looks like propaganda is in the eye of the beholder.
And it's interesting that you say that, because that is what Russian media would like us all to believe. And actually, the editor-in-chief, Margarita Simonyan, had actually said that there is no such thing as an objective truth. Everything is a matter of perspective. But if you think about that, that can be so easily manipulated, then you can make anything up and say, well, that's my truth. You know, you can get any far right, far left, 9/11 truther, crazy person and say, well, you know what, we're giving this person, this is this person's version of the truth. And I think that can get very dangerous in news and journalism.
Liz, this would be great for us to continue, but I don't want to continue if I know that someone has any questions.